Uganda Advanced Certificate of Education exam results today at State House. The Uganda National Examinations Board disclosed that this time round the female candidates were fewer than the males, but they performed better than their male counterparts. According to Dan Odong, the UNEB Executive Director, more females obtained more than two principal passes as compared to the male, and this has been the case for the past three consecutive years.
Although they are fewer in number than the male candidates, as you saw from the registration, proportionally they have performed better than their male counterparts. The percentage passes at the upper levels of 3Ps and 2Ps are higher, while percentage passes at the lower levels and failure rates among the female candidates are lower than that of the males.
The results also indicate that 99.1% of the candidates qualify for the award of a USCE certificate, while 73.7% qualify to be admitted at the university. This reflects a huge improvement from 70.3% in 2022. The results indicate that 80,643 students meet the minimum requirement of two principal passes for admission to university.
At the two principal pass level and above, this year 2023, 73.7% of the candidates passed with two Ps and above, compared to 70.3 in 2022, indicating better performance. And this, Mama, continues down the line, and we observe that those that have one subsidiary pass at a principal level subject, those that have failed is only 0.9%, 99.1% of our candidates.
We note that, once again, female candidates have performed better proportionally than the males at all levels and have shown a lower failure rate.
UNEB is also impressed that more candidates registered for science subjects, with mathematics showing the greatest promise. Statistics indicate that the number of students opting for mathematics increased from 38,776 in 2022 to 45,414 in 2023.
Candidates registering and appearing for mathematics are generally also gradually increasing, Mama, with mathematics showing the greatest promise. This can be seen in table 6 below. However, the overall numbers have remained well below half the total candidature. Mama, this is consistent with the fact that pass rates in these subjects in the Uganda Certificate of Education, UCE examination, have been low, and this impacts on the transition to the UACE level.
According to statistics, a total of 110,553 candidates registered for the 2023 USCE exams from 2,102 centers. USCE candidature rose by 12.9% from 97,890 candidates in 2022. 47,226, that is 42.7%, were females, and the males were 63,339, reflecting 57.3%. 1,065 candidates missed the USCE exams despite registering, reflecting a 0.9% decline in candidate absenteeism. 24,679, that is 22.3% candidates, were registered under UPOLET. The special needs candidates were 358 compared to 222 in 2022. Candidate absenteeism reduced by 0.9%. 34 inmates were registered from Luzira prisons. Of these, 30 were males and 4 were female. In terms of performance, 52,452, that is 47.9%, obtained three principal passes. 28,191, that is 25.8%, obtained two principal passes. 18,000, 624, that is 17.0%, obtained one principal pass, while 9,225 obtained a subsidiary pass. 996, that is 0.9%, had no pass. In a nutshell, 99.1% of the candidates qualify for the award of a USCE certificate. 73.7% qualify for university admission if a requirement is maintained at two principal passes. The number of those that qualify for university admission rose from 70.3% in 2022 to 73.7% in 2023. 90.7% qualify for admission to other tertiary institutions. This indicates a significant increase in university entries compared to the previous years. In terms of gender, females performed better than the male students, excelling in all subjects apart from chemistry and biology. In terms of subjects, more candidates excelled in entrepreneurship, CRE, geography, and literature. However, female entries for sciences and mathematics remain significantly low. The number of candidates opting for math greatly increased.
We are held where the President Museveni was the chief guest. So women, we congratulate you. We hope women emancipation is really taking place. I have a panel of experts to help you enrich your understanding and broaden your perspective. I have Professor Muhammad Mpezanigo, he's the Vice Chancellor of Kampala International University. And I have the Deputy Director of Studies at Indeje Secondary School, that is Brenda Ampumuza. We have one of the stars of the just released results, that is A-level, Aliya Sanyu Rukwago. She scored 19 points. She had the combination of PCM, stroke computer studies, that is chemistry, mathematics and computer studies. She scored 19 points. She was at Nabisunsa Girls High School. And then we have Vincent Elon. Vincent is the chairperson of the Professional Science Teachers Union here in Uganda. Professor Celestino Bua is going to join us online to help us make sense of that, whether he also expects universities, especially public universities, to raise the cutoff points, especially for highly competitive sponsored courses, government-sponsored courses, like it has been the case. Whenever there is improved performance, then universities tighten points. I welcome my guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Press World. Thank you for making it. We are here because of the UCE results, and I want to bring in Aliya Sanyu Rukwago. She's the daughter of the Kampala Road Mayor Elias Rukwago. Sanyu, welcome to Press World. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I'm very honored to be part of this panel.
Yes, yes. How do you feel? You're one of the star performers.
I'm very excited, and I really thank God, because it's not been easy through the journey. As sciences, they have not been easy for me personally, especially biology. I had to put in a lot of work, but I'm really grateful for the teachers who have stayed by my side and also my fellow students. Yes, I'm really grateful.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. I'm sure Vincent is very happy with you, because now we're joining sciences where still the performance is not that good, but biology, there was an improvement, especially in the performance of biology. So many of your colleagues, of course, did not make it. Others were not even able to sit for the exams, because we have seen 110 candidates registered for the exams, but 190,000 were able to sit for the exams. So you are one of the lucky ones who sat, but you also scored highly. What do you attribute your success to?
Well, my parents have been really supportive, and I really thank God for my parents. I've really found it, okay, the major concern is the books. For example, in biology, the books are really expensive to afford. So in certain schools, it's quite hard to have the books. So also getting access to the resources is also a concern. The determination of the students also really is important. So that's what I have, yes.
Thank you very much. Professor Mpisamihigo,
yes,
you have heard from our report. Mm-hmm. The general performance is, the overall performance is better. And so now parents and some students, some of them are worried that they may not be able to be offered their preferred courses of choice. What do you make of the general performance, the overall performance results?
Yeah, first of all, I thank Urban TV management and
my colleagues here, the panelists. Congratulations to our students. You know, everybody is celebrating for those who made it. I think the general overview of the announcement of the results gives us hope that life and education generally are coming back to normal. Maybe the audience has also forgotten, but the lockdown period isn't far away from us. You know, it's just about 2 years since we reopened. So we are beginning to see parents trying to remobilize themselves, schools also reorganizing themselves, teachers also getting back to their work. And I think for me, the reflection is that overall, it is a sign of normalcy that is getting back. And for us in the higher education subsector and other tertiary institutions, universities and other tertiary institutions, we are glad that we will have students who are going to apply for enrollment. Whether or not students will be able to get their dream courses is another matter, because it is different in the public from the private. The reason why there are, you know, significant issues of cutoff points and weights in the public universities is the fact that the best of the best all scramble for the few slots of government scholarship. And for us in the private, whereas we also meet the minimum standards, but we increase access, you know. So somebody doing medicine in a public university may be required to have extremely high grades, while in the private sector you'll find that they do qualify for medicine as long as they have got the minimum entry requirements. And also the best of the best in the private who join us are also given an opportunity. You may find students who have really performed very well but may be left out because of the cutoff policy, and it's not that the ones who have been left out actually do not qualify for that. So generally, we are very happy, and we congratulate the Uganda National Examinations Board, which has been consistent. Remember, recently they released the ones for UCE, and before that they also released from the primary level leaving examinations. This is the build-up of the structure of our education structure, strata. And we are happy that at least there is some continuity. I think later on we'll also be looking at what happens now that we are having an entry of a new curriculum, while we are also saying bye and an exit of the old, the so-called old curriculum, which is going now to also impact on the university curriculum system. Mm. Yeah.
Of course, we know A-level, the vision for the A-level curriculum was voted. They tested the lower secondary school curriculum and then see how things pan out. Thank you very much, Professor Mpisamihigo. Brenda Ampomuza.
Yes, sir.
What do you make of the results?
Thank you very much, moderator. To all the viewers, good morning, everyone. About the USCE results that were released, first of all, I want to congratulate everyone, the students, the parents, and all the stakeholders of the education sector upon the excellent performance generally, because when you look at the statistics, generally students did well. And maybe on a selfish note, I congratulate the students of NJSS staff and administration upon the excellent performance. There is a hope, because you see there's a shift. Everywhere there's a shift in the number of students first that register. Because when you see that we recovered from COVID, there was a decline. 2021, we didn't seat candidates, but 2022, there was a decline because some students had lost hope, some parents had lost hope. You know, finances had gone down. Some people weren't able to take their children back to school. So when we see this kind of improvement in enrollment first and performance, then we are glad and we thank God that at least we seem to be recovering completely from COVID and we are taking a firm stand now that we are moving forward. Of course, the improvement, especially in sciences, is commendable because there's a lot of government effort towards improvement of performance in science. So when there is a shift, no matter how small it is, we as taxpayers, you know, educationists, we are glad and thankful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Brenda. Yes, Vincent, are you very happy with the results?
I'm extremely very happy. Because I think the teachers seem to be getting it right across board. But when you look at the statistic, as my colleagues have indicated, having the number of students and percentage that can join public university shoot from the usual 50-60%, now we are at 73.7%.
Actually, in 2022, it was 70%. We are 70%. So those we have two principal passes.
We have gone to 74. But it has been also consistent because I was able to look back 2016, 2015, 2012. You could see a progressive increase in the number of students that are joining public university. And then when you put up, those ones also were able to proceed to tertiary institution, I think the performance has been good. Because now we are at 90%, leaving a very small percentage.
So, Dr. Mpizaminga will tell us, he had talked about how within the situation is different as far as admission is concerned. I think they may not be considering the cutoff points and whatever. She will explain. But I'm told the Professor Bua, once we get him, is on. Can we have Professor Bua? Well, we shall. We are trying to link up with him via Zoom or the phone. Professor Mpizaminga.
Their male counterparts.
Those ones who, when you look at the upper levels,
yes, three, per, yeah.
Three and two, the number is very high. Yet, actually, the irony is that there are fewer in terms of numbers.
Yes.
Because when you look at it, there are 42% who
start versus 50.
And compared to 57.
Yes.
For the male counterpart, they still posted.
Thank you very much. The analysis of the results needs to consider quite a lot of other factors. Number one, we should note that students who sit A level have got a background of primary level studies. They also have a background of the secondary school level, O level plus A level. Now, I may use the word crop. It's a crop, you know, that comes following. Even teachers agree, schools agree, even within the university system, there are years that you really see that in a class, if there are 10 female students and the majority are boys, in that class and that particular year, the performance is, you know, exceptional. So we need to understand the explanation of having fewer girls performing better, because remember, they sit in independent examination centers. They are from different backgrounds. They are using different schools. So making a conclusion and trying to justify their performance requires, I think, additional information. But maybe if we can segregate the data at some point and look at that high performance, is it limited to urban schools? You know, we need to do some digging deeper into the data. Is it the female students who performed very well in that category? Where are the majority coming from? What could be the factors that influenced their performance? How are the rural areas, you know, represented? Because you may find, and which schools contributed the biggest number. So there are factors that we need to understand, but generally it's a very positive outcome for us to have the female students out competing their male counterparts. So that's what I can say. But usually these students don't just come from A level, just senior six. We shouldn't consider them in their last term of their A level. We also have to track their history, their academic history. You'll find that some of those students have actually consistently been excelling in their studies. So if we are given an opportunity, I think somebody needs to do this study and analysis so that we tease out all the factors and build on that. For example, if we found that the rural districts have actually now contributed a larger percentage of the girls who have outperformed the boys, then maybe the government can put together centers of excellence or satellite schools where more girls can be given access in those regions and therefore enable them access, you know, good professional courses, you know, like medicine, engineering, and pharmacy, and IT, computer science. These are programs that are going to influence the future, as you already know. But most of our girls are actually do not have access because they come dropping off, or their performance becomes poor by the time they reach A level. They cannot compete at the national level. So generally, I think we need to study it more. But it's a very good outcome. And for us in the university system, we hope those students will have an opportunity to join universities and undertake their courses, dream courses like Alia. Alia probably is already aware of what she wants to become, because we need to have that conversation. Sometimes when they pass, they also have a confusion. She has all the subjects well done. Our O level must have been excellent. Now the dilemma is, do I do medicine? Do I go and do engineering if she had physics, chemistry? And so on and so forth. So that becomes an issue. And don't be surprised if she says, no, dad, she tells her dad that those grades were for A level. My dream is in arts and culture. These are the challenges we normally have.
Thank you.
Yes.
Talking about Alia, did you expect the results? Were you surprised or you expected the results?
Yes, I've been performing well since my senior five, since I went to Navisunsa.
But how did you perform at O level?
At my O level, I got 11 aggregates, yes. Mm-hmm. And I'm really grateful. When I went to A level, starting biology was really tricky for me.
But you got a D1
in O level. In O level biology, I got a D2.
D2.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so I was really having a conflict between physics and biology, what should I take? But my background is, I've always loved medicine. I've always loved seeing people being helped out, because my dad personally has been through quite a lot. He has been sick, and me sitting there seeing him suffer, yet I could do something about it, really motivated me to keep pushing. So I really have a passion in medicine, and I just decided to take biology. But I really wanted to change combinations after starting BCM for first term in senior five, because I found biology really hard to read because it has large volumes of books and the competition was really tight. But I sought out counselors, I went to my mentors, and they told me, I showed them my results for first term, and they just said, you're really joking, because they know that people have got worse results, but they've still been able to make it. So I'm really grateful that I've been able to make it throughout my A-level. And yes, I wasn't really surprised for my results, though my parents were surprised, yes.
So you're going to pursue, you're going to study medicine?
Yes.
So what did you make of the performance, the results, the general performance when you look at it?
I'm really happy for the girls being better than the boys, because there's always that competition for girls proving that they're actually better. But nevertheless, there's still some challenges that we go through as girl child. And as a girl who has done sciences, the hardships I've seen during my journey, I have not been able to fully express myself in academics because of maybe challenges that come around, social challenges. I've not been able to be an all-round, but I have tried. I engaged in clubs. I've gone for National Science Olympiad, National Mathematics Contest, and that has improved in my practical skills, in my critical thinking skills, and I'm really grateful for that, yes.
Thank you very much. Brenda,
yes, sir.
When you look at, first of all, your school, I don't know if you are to break down your performance, but when you look at the performance of girls at O level and P7, PRE results, when they were released, they showed that girls were strong in English and but now the situation has seemed they have beaten boys at this high level. What do you make of that?
Thank you very much. First of all, if I start by commenting on the numbers, the difference in the numbers of girls and boys opting for A-level, you find that after O-level, girls are taken up by so many things. You see, like Aliyah has said, there are so many challenges that these girls face that deter them from exploiting their full potentials. But also, you find that just at entry, girls are fewer than boys. Some have opted for courses like nursing, others have gone for saloon. There are quite a number of options that are more to the girls alone than the boys, because you find there are fewer boys doing certificate in nursing, for example. There may be fewer boys opting for courses like hairdressing, fashion and design, things like that, which some students opt for just at O level. But then, the difference in performance for example, Ndeji Senior Secondary School, this is not a shock. It's not news that boys are tending to go down as the girls are going up. Nationally or internationally, there is effort to raise up the woman. That effort is there. And I think to some extent, there is a way the effort to raise up the woman is somehow ignoring the boy child. And if nothing is done and we keep with this trend, you may find that time will come and we shall have raised the woman much higher, and then the boy will have gone much lower, and then maybe at some time we shall need affirmative action for the boy child or something like that. Because you find that if there are two cases and it's about a boy child and a girl child, the conditions of the girl child are going to be a little bit softer. If it is they are on the road and they are moving and someone wants to say, let me help, they may be, you know, bent to helping the girl child. So for us as Ndeje Senior Secondary School, last year we said we are putting in deliberate effort, which I want to call the whole nation, international-wise, to come up and strike a balance between the boy child and the girl child. And in this effort, the school launched the club we call the Men of Valor to intentionally nurture the boy child. And for us, our results, except for the arts where there are more girls than boys, that's why we have most of the best students girls, but for the science there is there is a reasonable balance between the boy child and the girl child in, as far as performance is concerned. Because for that, there is intentional effort. These boys are being groomed, they are being counseled, they are having men, fellow men of valor, as teachers, as fellow students, talk to them and put them in order. So there is need that we all embrace this and don't leave the boy child as we work on the girl. The girl child. So we need to come up with intentions, because the boys are there, they're struggling. They also have challenges. They need people to listen to them. They need to talk to someone. And I think we need to come up and bridge that gap. Of course, I am happy for the fellow ladies because they excelled. But as a mother, as an educationist dealing with both boys and girls, I would want to see a balance between the performance of boys and girls, so that we don't ruin one side.
How is the situation at Indeji in terms of performance? Did the girls also outcompete boys?
Yes, in the arts class, by design, there are more girls opting for the arts subjects, more girls. So the best students in the arts, more are girls. But when you go to the science class, which is reasonably balanced with more boys actually than girls, then we have.
Yes, Brenda, I'm told Professor. Good morning, Professor Bua.
Good morning,
Good. So we are trying to link up with you via Zoom, but I think you have had some technical issues. Yes.
What? Now some sound is coming via Zoom.
Yes, we are trying to link up with you. Via Zoom, but I'm
told. I'm getting some sound from Zoom. So maybe we could try
those. Okay, Professor. Let's try that. Thank you very much, Professor.
So I'm getting the sound is from the studio, but not from the...
They brought it, I'm the one engaging you on the phone, my mobile phone, because of the technical. But since you have said they are sorting it out, let's see, link up. So, Professor, yeah, I see now. I think let's continue now. What do you, the results you released on Thursday have shown that more students qualify for university. Actually, thousands more are qualifying for university. What does that mean?
Thank you so much, Umaru. Good morning, listeners. Good morning, my colleagues who are in the studio. Due to some technical problems, I'm not being able to join you in the studio because I'm upcountry for some other issues. Regarding the past level that we reported on Thursday, the good news is therefore that our learners are performing better, which is good for the country. It is also good for the teachers, which is an indication that they have done a good job. I think importantly, for the students, it means that they are given a good accountability for the efforts that they are putting in.
And a good accountability, of course, to their parents and sponsors, because if you are funded to as a student, the accountability is to pass very well. So for us, we are proud and happy. As you know, we are happy that the pass rate has gone up, and we think that is good for the candidate. It is also good for the admitting institutions, higher institutions of higher learning, because it means that they will be getting better grades, good candidates for programs that they offer in their various institutions.
So we are seeing that, according to your report, you say that core subjects, still the performance is not that desirable. What can be done to improve the situation?
Well, not all core subjects. Some core subjects had challenges. There were some issues with some core subjects. Not all were badly done. I think when you look through our results, you will see that While we have seen some improvement in biology, it is still very low, only 0.2%. But that translates to 19,000 students. So when you look at disciplines or programs that require biology as a core subject, then you'll have fewer candidates to offer those. But for we are very impressed with the performance in mathematics, because you can see that the performance in mathematics increased from 38,000 in 2022 to 45,000 this year. And in fact, when you talk to many parents whose children offered mathematics, I think they were very gratified that the children passed mathematics very well. Mathematics is really one of the core subjects that are needed almost for every other discipline. So we are happy with that. But of course we think that the number of students who are taking core science subjects is still not high enough. And if you remember, the Honorable Minister made that remark to say we want to see more students taking science subjects.
You managed to reverse the trend as far as the registration of candidates is concerned, but also the absenteeism, the rate, as you have been able to reduce, it has been reduced by 0.5%. But we see many over 1,000 this time, this 2023, we are not able to appear for the exams. Although you have reduced the absenteeism rate, what can be done to ensure that all candidates who register do sit the exams? Because now I thought you schools allow students to sit and then be able to pay fees later. I thought that was the major challenge schools were facing and students.
Thank you very much, Mr. Omar. I think we have not yet indicated why absenteeism still remains relatively high. It is something that we need to carry out. As the Ministry of Education needs to find out what is happening with this absenteeism. We know that you cannot say you're going to completely exclude absenteeism, because a child can fall sick just during examination. There are various reasons why a child may miss examination, sickness or whatever reason, but I wouldn't particularly say it is due to fees or registration. Because once a child has been registered, it means that the school has okayed that child to sit for examination. And so for us, we do not know why a child may absent themselves from attending or sitting the examination. But it is something that the schools can find out. And normally we give an examination performance report back to schools. And this helps them, this should help them to find out some of the challenges that we report. Mr. Isaka and listeners, you need to realize that the UNEV is only a dashboard of what goes on from the learning cycle up to the time the child is assessed at the end of the cycle. So UNEV may not be the one to give answers to why absenteeism still persists, but I think schools can be the ones to give those answers.
Now, on the lips of many parents and students, senior six leavers, is that are we expecting to see universities raising the cutoff points?
Okay, thank you for that question. You know, cutoff points is not predetermined, and I think my colleague Professor Mpeza Mohika, who is there, would also attest to that universities do not set cutoff points before admission. Cutoff points are determined by the number of students who have applied, the number of students that the institution want to admit. We normally rank the students from the best performer to the lowest performer for that particular program. And the points that would have been generated by those candidates. If there are 1,000 students and we want to admit 20, we admit the first 20 from the first top 20. And the point where the 20th candidate get will be the cutoff point. So it is not something predetermined. It can be high, it can be low, depending on the number of students that the institution want to admit. So yes, it's likely that a cutoff point might be high this year because of the good performance of the students. But that is good for admitting institutions because you know you're getting good quality students into your program.
Will the performance of girls see boys outcompeted in terms of opportunity choices at the university?
Thank you very much. You see, the good thing what we have found out in the analysis of the results for this year is that girls actually perform very well, even in the science subjects. And when you look at their performance based on the desegregation based on sex, you see that girls still actually outperform in terms of proportion, they outperform the boys. That in itself tells you that they are capable to do well, even in some of the difficult, what was perceived as difficult subjects. So girls are able to do equally or even better than boys. And you realize that in a number of programs in the university, quite a number of girls actually do excel, others getting first class or getting distinctions in the programs that they have taken. So girls actually do perform well even in the university.
Professor, lastly, because you said you will not be with us in the next hour, you are traveling for Barrio. The quality in your report also, your neighbor report, said that the quality of the candidates' work improved. When you look at the core, the mean score, what do you make of that? And the challenges that you highlighted of concentrating a lot on theory and paying less attention to practicals and other things. Even the ICT, you say there are still challenges there.
Thank you, Omar. Yes, we did note that, and this was a report of examiners. You see, when examiners conduct their marking, they provide a report on they assess the performance of the students. So we do recognize that certain subjects are faced with issues to do with equipment, which would otherwise have improved performance. So ICT requires equipment in terms of computers and sometimes printers, because when a student is learning ICT on a computer, sometimes they need to print out the work that they have done. And so lack of computers and printers is a big disadvantage. It's like if a student is taking chemistry and the school does not have a proper chemistry lab, there is no way that these children would have learned theory and then come and carry out practical exams. So those are some of the challenges that some schools meet. And this is an issue that as a country we need to see how to address. How do we ensure that all schools have almost all the requirements needed for learners in a particular subject? We want to assume that the absence of equipment, the absence of practical requirements makes the students not perform well. Now, let me explain a little further. Practicals give better understanding to the theory that is taught. So if the students are not able to see in practice some of the concepts that have been taught theoretically, they will have a very difficult time understanding and appreciating and responding to questions which require interpreting or explaining certain concepts because they did not see it happening. So that is where we say practicals give support to the theory that is being taught. So that's something that we think that schools need to ensure that when they decide that they're going to have students take particular subjects, there should be effort made to ensure that the practical aspect of those subjects are also taught. And that way, students will be able to answer the questions better, other than just teaching the theory and they not understand well how to explain certain things because they never saw it in practice.
What is your last word, Professor, to Ugandans there and the schools out there?
First of all, I would like to thank you, Bonomaro, and the Uban team for inviting me to be part of this discussion. And I'm sure I didn't get what my colleagues in the studio have said, but I'm very sure that they will be probably saying something similar to what I've been saying. Now, to our students, to the learners who have received their results, I want to encourage, particularly those who may not have performed well, that there are opportunities which they can take. Instead of everybody scrambling to join the university, there are other higher institution programs that one can take. And what we have seen in the country is that those are the ones that give employability. Those who do technical programs who are not necessarily degree but diploma, they are the bulk of the people employed in industry. It is the diploma holders that are largely employed in industry. So the opportunity for employability is higher with those who have done diploma programs. So I want to encourage them. For those who have done well, congratulations, jubilate, but prepare yourself for university learning because that also has its own interests but challenges as well. Because nobody will hold your hand in the university. You kind of have to do the learning yourself.
Professor, before we leave you, I don't know whether my panelists, anyone who has something to say to Professor Bua, as far as the exams are concerned. Vincent, is there anything you would want UNEP to change? Or?
One, I have got concerned from teachers, especially science. They are not sure of the area to be examined for practical, especially for new lower curriculum. And teachers are gambling, trying to, because the UNEP has not come out, and even the National Curriculum Development Center has not come out to clarify which area. And if time is running, we already have the first lot of candidates in senior four. We are not sure whether what teachers are coming up with is the right content for practicals. So maybe he can clarify on that.
We still have a professor? Hello? I think we may have lost him, but I think we will try to ensure that he may clarify on that very issue. But Professor, you heard from your fellow professor, he was saying that he is also expecting stiff cutoffs, especially in public universities. Explain to us how, for you in private sector, how you go about it.
Yeah, thank you very much. I want to thank Professor Bua, who is my colleague. He's also the Vice-Chancellor of Mbarara University of Science and Technology. I also served with him on the UNEB board, so for a period. The task I would want to propose to UNEB is, I know they process exams, they process results, they also guide on performance. I know that there is a strong research committee that needs to be funded so that together with other stakeholders within the education sector, they can actually try to dig deeper in the analysis of the performances and trying to connect. You heard when you asked him about trying to explain some of the reasons why some students actually register. They even, by the time they register, they have paid for exams and then they are absent. And he said that the school should be able to provide that information, and he's right. But then UNEB Research Committee
should be able to go out there and try to tease out some of these reasons. And actually, their research, working together with also other institutions, could give us some kind of hints on what needs to be done on the segregation of this information, and trying to also to map. I think we need to have a UNEB mapping of the whole country in terms of performances, core factors by region. And so when the ministry wants to do interventions with other stakeholders, it's actually a targeted intervention. The problems of female students in Karamoja sub-region cannot be the same as the ones in Mbarara. It can't be the same. You know, even the weather itself is different, the classroom environment is different, what they need is different. The teachers could actually be considered for the hardship support because they are in a very difficult place. Maybe access to internet to enrich resources in schools. So UNEB is the organ, which I think the body that could actually assist to produce additional research information that can guide policy. And also we look at the future and ask ourselves, how do we go about supporting these students who actually are not necessarily weak academically, but because of the social economic factors surrounding them, actually that pulls them down in terms of performance. As for my colleague from Ndeje, the issue of targeting boys, actually it is now a big issue. You will find that in the beginning when Makerere University passed this policy of 1.5, so many female students went through. Now we are also understanding that the female support system has actually brought in more girls almost in higher education. But again, as she has rightly said, there's also some imbalance now beginning to future where boys seem to be left behind, and therefore we need to have that addressed. With the issue of admission, in addition to what Professor Obua said, the issue of cutoff points. First of all, the National Council for Higher Education accredits programs, and those programs are also given.
I think of course we want to take a breather.
Yes. Yes.
I think when I come, I'll allow to conclude on that issue. And then I bring in my other panelists. I'm sure Vincent will tell us what needs to be done as well as teaching practical.
Yeah.
Practicals are concerned because you featured prominently in the report of the UNEB. Stay tuned to Urban TV. This is Press World. I'm your host, Umaru Kashaka. That quick break. This is the Press World here on Urban TV. I'm Umaru Kashaka. We hope the show is enriching your understanding as a viewer and broadening your perspective. I have a panel of experts helping us to analyze the just released Uganda Advanced Certificate of Examination results for 2023. Before we went into that break, Professor Mpeza Migo, the Vice Chancellor of Kampala International University, was the one holding the floor on the issue of cutoff yes points.
Yes,
and now you do it. That's
yes. I was saying that the cutoff points are determined, as he has rightly said, as Professor Boa said. First of all, the number of students who are applying into that particular program. Each academic program, as my colleagues may be aware, when you design a program, you also determine the kind of essential subjects, the subjects that could be of added advantage, and also the grades that you'd expect. So a student comes from A level and then applies, let us say, for medicine or engineering or education, whatever it is, or law. So the more students you have, the more options you have also in determining who gets in. But in addition, the National Council for Higher Education, actually, when accrediting programs, they also give a number that you must consider. So that also plays as a key factor, because you cannot exceed the number that you have been given, because then they have already matched your facilities, your teaching capacity, and so on and so forth. Those in the secondary school education may not be in the know of this requirement at university. So we use that to control quality and say now you qualify, but if now the cutoff has left you out, we also have these related options. So we move them into other academic programs and so on and so forth. So you end up having giving opportunities of access to university education to a variety of students.
So how do you do it there?
First of all, Kampala International University is a comprehensive university. We do have more than 200 academic programs that are accredited in the arts, in the humanities, social sciences, in the health sciences, in the engineering sciences, in law studies, in education, computing, and so on and so forth. So what we do, students apply online. Others also come physically. They buy forms. Those who apply online are given also a verdict online. And when they come for registration, when they come physically to the university, then during the process of registration, we ensure we verify the academic documents. You know, Umar, that these days a lot of fraud goes on. A lot of document falsification takes place. So we verify, we also tally that with the results from UNEB. So UNEB, like now they have released results, we shall get an entire set of the O level, we get an entire set of the A level for that particular year. And then when students apply, whereas they have submitted the copies of their O level and A level, we still have teams that actually do a verification. And so a student may be admitted provisionally, and then the verification is done before the end of the semester. So that's how we do it.
Thank you very much. Vincent, when I look at the report on the improved quality of candidates' work with higher mean scores in many subject areas where performance has been reported to have improved, like Professor said there, Professor Bua, notable has been biology, where performance has been rather poor in the past years. The UNEB says the core science subjects continue to show lower than desired principal performance levels. The factors responsible for this, they say, include teaching theoretically with the candidates lacking in practical skills to perform experiments, record and interpret their results. What do you make of that?
I want to partly agree with that submission. Because of the gross inequality in our education system. If you look back like something like 40 years, 50 years back, you would have a farmer bring a child, take a child to any school of his or her choice. But we seem to be moving away from that. And the number of schools that don't have these facilities are increasingly going up. I went to the village and I looked at the status of some schools. You know, when you stay in Kampala, you may not know. And once UNEB gives assessment, it is for all Ugandans. It is not for Nabisunza. It is not for Gayaza, Namagunga, Budu, Ndeje. It is for all those schools, including those seed schools which doesn't have laboratories. And some of them have failed even to attract competent, qualified professional teachers, schools in Karamoja, deep in the village there. So this still goes back to government. But when you look at performance, when you analyze for the past 10 years, you would see an improved performance in all disciplines, and more actually in sciences. We are seeing a shift because math, the number of students that offered math in A level, when you look at these results, is higher than all other subjects. 45,000. I think second is, apart from general paper, which is compulsory, the second is entrepreneurship, which is at 40,000. So, but again, when you look at the performance registered in math over years,
This is not what we used to experience like 10 years ago. I was able to look at the UNEV results 10 years ago. Of course, math doesn't have practical, but sometime I was also on a show here, and I was able to showcase why biology is still struggling, whereas math has already gone up. Math does not have a practical paper, but also the method of assessment of these papers determines. Sometimes it is the problem is not coming from the school. You find that some subjects are a little bit strict. Take for instance math, when they are marking, they give methods. But when it comes to chemistry, you write an equation, you fail to balance, it is wrong. My student will agree with me. You write an equation and something is wrong, a symbol, and it is a long equation. You are given zero. Biology has a little bit more challenges, especially in practical. You will find that the practical resources, because science is best taught experimentally in the lab, as Professor put it, because students must first appreciate the practical in order to appreciate the theory. Now, majority of these schools are struggling. They don't even have laboratories. I happened to go to a school where we did only three chemistry practical, and then went for UNEV. Now you can guess,
Professor.
You can guess what we did. Of course, we had majority of students score passes an F9, but for me, I was able to pull off a distinction, and I was the only one because I did an extra work. Not all students are able to do that in such a status. So this now comes partially to government. The sole responsibility of educating Ugandans lies solely on the hand of government. And private sectors are just trying to help, because the future of this country is in the hand of this young generation. If we fail to invest money, look at the amount of money that is given to the budget for education. We are struggling. That's why they even put the A-level competent curriculum on a hold, implementation. Why? Because of funds. Here I can tell you categorically, it is funds. We are struggling even to train teachers. There are schools that are teaching old curriculum because the teachers have not been trained. Thank God for these good schools, and there are not many. And if you do a holistic research, you will find that these good results are coming from few schools. Majority of the schools down there, which doesn't have these infrastructures, they don't have the teachers, they don't have the equipment in the laboratories. When you are told, the other day I was watching one of the students from a very good school, say their school, whenever there is a practical, every learner has a specimen. If it is a rat, but some schools, they may even just dissect one rat, and it is a group what?
Practicals.
And you'll find that a student does not have the feel of doing it themselves. Yet in the examination, they are supposed to do it.
As an individual.
Now, these are some of the things that keep on coming.
And what are you doing as leaders? Because
we have raised it during the World Teachers Day, and government committed to address that. We had an industrial action. It was one of our key points. And the Minister of Education admitted that they were going to address that. But sometimes, when you take long, they shift it to the schools. And you will find that some of these schools does not have the fund to provide for these practical equipment and build these laboratories.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I have seen, Brenda, you are nodding your head in agreement.
Yes.
You agree with him on that very issue?
Yes, yes, thank you very much. I agree with my chairperson on a number of issues. You see, when we look at the results that UNEB displays and we are saying this percentage has passed, this is not doing well, and these are the reasons, I think there is something we don't get to find out as a country. There is a big disparity in performance. It is big. There is a school out there which could have not even registered a best grade at day level. So when we are explaining, maybe if there is a way they could structure these results, and they would have structured interventions, because sometimes the challenges of students here in the center, as my friend Aliyah could put to us, they are slightly different than what students are going through elsewhere. Because we have schools here, for example, in the JSS, we have everything we need. The learners are well facilitated, the teachers are well facilitated, the practicals are done regularly. But that could not be the case elsewhere. Yes. So at least as we are looking at what is affecting performance, if we could structure, and maybe we categorize schools so that we get intentional interventions for particular areas. Otherwise, when we keep on saying teaching theoretically, it doesn't cut across. Some schools are actually teaching practically, but they are schools, it is true.
Where
the facilities are not, like the school is not there, and we've seen them, you people of TV cover those stories, we've seen them. So there needs to be intervention, there needs to be intention to make education reach everyone, and that education should be quality. Mm-hmm. Not this thing of, you know, they have, these ones have passed, these ones have failed. When you look at the number of students not going to make it to university, are they equally distributed across the country? You know, because you could be saying this percentage is not making it 0.9. It is small, true, but it could be big depending on the areas that are affected. Because there could be a district not going to have a person represent them, for example, in a particular course at university. So those differences affect students differently, and I feel like there should be need for structured interventions so that we cater for the causes of poor performance other than bracketing it and leaving it as if the whole country in the teaching fraternity is undergoing the same challenges, yet they are different. Mm. Thank you very
yes,
much.
Professor, before I bring in Aria.
Yes, actually I think we shouldn't only be lamenting about the problem, year in, year out. As I mentioned earlier, and I'll give an example from our perspective as a university, Kampala International University. We decided many years ago to launch medicine, Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery, and the requirements are very simple, okay? You must have qualified students who join to do medicine. You must have qualified staff who teach, but most importantly, when it comes to clinical years, you must have the patients and the consultants. Now, Kampala International University has its own teaching hospital. It is not sufficient, okay, for certain disciplines. And so what we did is to enter into memoranda of understanding with regional referral hospitals of Fort Portal, Hoima, Lira, Mubende, Kiriandongo, Jinja, and Kayunga. And so when the clinical rotations reach, we do not have to have all those hospitals as belonging to the university. Now, if I scale that to the example we have, I don't believe it's even a good idea that every school should have perfection like our school here in Ndeje. No, or every university should have perfection. We can actually pull resources together. For example, we can create centers, you know, of scientific labs, and we say all UNEB students in these three districts will actually convene. So it is easier for the government, or even we can encourage private investors to set up central labs, just like we have Uganda Virus Research Institute. When we had COVID, all the labs were taking their samples to UVRI, and then the results were distributed. So we can actually pool those resources
and say we start by establishing satellite centers for science labs, like for physics, for chemistry, for biology. And then by the time the other schools get capacity, we shall have assisted the students. I mean, I don't see a problem if, let's say, we take for Karamoja, we say, okay, there will be transport, our central lab, science, physics lab will be in Moroto. Then the other one will be in Kabong, so that there's equal distribution. And then when we go there, even UNEB will find it easier because the invigilators will be centrally pulled in there. I think we need to think outside the box. There's no promise at all when these schools will ever have full capacity that would give access to our students. That is my explanation, basing on what we are doing now in KIU, and I can guarantee that students who rotate in those 9 regional referral hospitals become excellent because they are exposed to different settings. We can as well do it, and I think for physics, chemistry, biology, agriculture, and all other practicals, they are easier than actually delivering human medicine at university level. And so the ministry needs to think out of the box, bring stakeholders on board. If we have companies in those districts, we can ask them to make a contribution, and then we are able to set up state-of-the-art centers of excellence for science practicals where even the private universities, we can even ask schools that you'd have spent so much, so many millions, now only spend less as part of counterfunding towards the establishment of such science facility.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
I wanted to bring Aliyah, and then I can come back to you on that issue. Aliyah, I saw when Vincent was soon going to be your leader, was making his point on the issues of practicals and teaching theories and practicals. You were nodding your head in agreement. What can be done to reverse the situation, the regional imbalances, to ensure that even a person in hard to reach areas, like the districts of Ontoroko, they can be able to post the results you have posted?
Thank you. I think they should increase on the facilities because, of course, you know, the test tubes and all that are used in the practical lessons, most of them can get damaged really easily. So the way that we manage the resources or the facilities that we have is really important. And also that part of qualified teachers, some of them are actually part-time teachers. So you can find that they can come to school maybe only once a week, and they'll only go to the schools where obviously they are paid more. So I feel like we should increase also the salaries of the teachers who are teaching the certain subjects.
Government increased for science.
Yes, government increased.
It's very happy now with the government. No more straight. Yes, go ahead.
They increased for science teachers, but since we are talking about an all-round, we are talking about also for arts, yes. So government should find other options of raising up the hopes of other teachers, not only science teachers, to maybe, I don't know, because salaries, obviously teachers also work so hard. I've seen arts teachers coming for night prep lessons. They spend their night trying to explain to students. So I feel like also the point of salaries should be put into consideration, yes, to improve the facilities and all that information given to the students.
And the young ones who are shunning sciences, what message do you give them, especially chemistry, biology?
Yes, I'd like to urge my fellows to be determined, to have the resilience. If you really want something, you can get it. It cannot be easy because there's no shortcut to any place worth going. So I really urge them, if they really have the love for the subject, it can be really interesting.
So it's about the love for
the subject. It's about the love, because if you don't love it, you can
not
easily
about
give
the facilities
up.
Where
there's a lot to put passion into consideration. Mm-hmm. But passion really matters in sciences.
Thank
yes.
you very much. Yes, Vincent.
Yes, I agree partly with the professor, especially when he was giving a solution, because sometimes we are very good in lamenting and we don't suggest. Yes. However, one of the things that, there are two things I want to comment on. One of the things that it is also very vital in teaching science. It is true that we have very few science teachers, very few. We may have many qualified science teachers, but few on government payroll. And I have the statistic because I lead them. We have about 10,000 science teachers across the country on government payroll. When it comes to humanity, there are over 22,000. Over 22,000. So because of that, there's, as she has put it, there's a lot of, has been a lot of moonlighting, and coupled with the low salaries, which has been the case, you find a teacher running to about three, four, five schools. But with the increased salary enhancement and the introduction of teller machine, we have seen teachers settle in their main station and delivering service. As I put it the always, that results are not achieved overnight. It is like planting beans. Then you wake up tomorrow, you want to harvest. You must give it time. The fact that we already have positive indicator that results are changing, we need to increase more positive factors. And I want to appeal to Minister of Education. They are aware of this challenge to recruit enough science teachers, because there are schools that you may not even have a biology teacher. And then they go down to get somebody who has failed A level to assist them. How do you expect that school to perform to the tune of the one in Kampala that can access these good teachers? And then there are regions, even in the medical. I have been in Mulago, and doctors told us, if you transfer me to Karamoja, I can't go. So the areas are regarded as hard to reach. So in order to attract those teachers and make them comfortable in any part of the country, government need to, first of all, recruit enough science teachers, then make sure they put up accommodation. At least this point, I raised it during World Teachers Day, and the First Lady and Honorable Minister of Education, including the President, made a very staunch directive that they are now moving on to construct teachers' houses. Because if you look in Kampala, there are still schools which don't even have one staff quarter. And you like schools which are in Kololo, you can go to City High, you don't have any staff quarter, and the houses there are quite expensive. To rent a room may cost $1 million. Now, teachers go very far. Now, in terms of delivery, the time they put to come to school, even when you want to tie them to be there more for students, when time reach, they will be rushing.
Stop moonlighting.
Yes. So, we are appealing to government to put up those. Then on the point of laboratories, the context of hospitals may be a little bit different, Professor. You see, when doctors are trained for, I think, 3-4 years, and then they go for internship, that's where they go for those practicals and the rest. But our students come to boarding, and the facilities must be there. I'm just looking at the number of doctors trained, and vis-a-vis the number of students offering science. If they are in maybe 40,000, and you distribute them for regions, you have 10,000 in the north, central 10, west 10. Now, how do you put up a facility for 10,000 students? So that contact in this lower level of learning may not apply. However, I have taught in a school where teachers are a little bit innovative. We didn't have even a single laboratory, because when you talk about practical, people first look at a laboratory room. Practical is not about a laboratory room. It's about having resources and effectively utilizing it. We just had a store, and this school used to perform. It's one of the schools I'm not going to mention in the central here. They just have a store. If you want to conduct a practical, you pull up what you want, and they bring it in the classroom. The classroom becomes a laboratory. You can even carry those gas cylinder if you want the source of heat in the class. You go with the patient and carry those test tubes and then distribute to the students. I think that innovation is what is supposed to go to some of those schools. However, the sensitivity towards providing these equipments and the materials is what we need to address, because there are schools where the head teacher or the management is not sensitive. They see like sciences is expensive. They compare it with other subjects. So when they are doing their budget, they're a little bit restricting. They are not sensitive towards the science. And yet government is encouraging a bigger enrollment and better performance in the science. So I think much have to be done on those schools so that the head teachers, the management team are a little bit sensitive. They know that sciences, you have to put in a little bit more money, because if a student is doing, like she did BCM, there is another student which has done egg, who doesn't do even one practical. But you will see the cost of higher education in Navis Hunza is a little bit more than the other one, yet they pay the same school fees. So that now comes to the head teacher and the management team. They have to do a little bit more and know that science is the backbone that all countries across the world are looking for towards innovation, research, and of course medicine, so that we can grow and develop. So I think the head teachers, the school administrators, and some of these schools that are coming, that government is starting, the seed schools, they need to ensure that these resources are there at the school.
Thank you very much. Yes, Brenda, on that issue, we want to conclude.
I hear Dr. Bauer.
They also need to be, government needs to look into them. I don't know how the solution is in the staff room. I'm told the people, those ones who are teaching sciences, they are not, the way they are looked at by their arts counterpart is not that good. How is the solution? What can be done?
Thank you very much. It is true, the economy presses us all equally, regardless of what you teach. But if government thought that they cannot handle all of us at once, I pray that we have hope in them, that they said phased. And we are also praying with our fellow teachers, because it may not be you as a person, but in a way or another, we are kind of interconnected together. You would want everyone to be a little bit comfortable so that we are doing that some kind of work. Mm-hmm. So since they said it is phased increment, we hope and pray that they keep their word, so that soon their salaries are also enhanced. It's not that what they gave science teachers is actually up there and they are so comfortable. You know how the economy is pressing us. There's a huge disparity in terms of payments as far as this country is concerned. There's one degree holder probably earning this 40 million, and then there's another degree holder earning, 500,000. I think there is, generally, there is need to harmonize salaries. Mm-hmm. That need is there, and whether arts or science, we hope that it is done. And for the record, the enhancements weren't made for teachers alone.
all other sectors where there are arts and science counterparts, the enhancements were made in partiality. So we pray that that funds allow soon and everyone is stepped up so that we can go to another phase. Because
I agree with Vincent when he says the future of this country is in science.
Not I agree with him partially that not science alone. We need each other. And in fact, I wouldn't say everyone should come and do science. For me, what I would say is whatever combination you take, excel in it. Because not everyone who is successful is actually a scientist. But there is need for technology, for innovation, for creativity, for development to occur. So if you can innovate in the art sector, well and good. So we need each other, we need everyone. But the intentional effort to bring up more scientists, it's good for the country. Mm. It's good, and we recommend it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Professor, I've seen you are also nodding your head in Dublin on the issue of sciences.
Yeah, the future. I think the future really is towards a multidisciplinary approach. At the university level, you know, when we admit both arts and sciences. And then when it comes to research, okay, so they have a body of knowledge that teaches them arts, social sciences, humanities, and the scientists are also taught. But then we do have cross-cutting courses that are mandatory. You don't want to produce a medical doctor who does not understand some anthropology and some, you know, social science behavior, the way, you know, the character of society. Because if you train him or her as a straight-jacketed medical doctor who just wants to work in theater, conduct an operation, without understanding the social psycho issues of even the patient attendants, so it becomes very unfortunate. So we try to do integration. And the ones who are going to pursue arts, social sciences and humanities, law and other art subjects shouldn't actually have any worry, because their relevance will still remain. And we are piloting a model at the university where we bring like 30 students from all the spheres, those doing law, those doing arts education, science education, engineering, applied psychology, development studies, social work, and we tell them, for example, the urban cities have got a problem of waste management. On the other side, we bring the IT and computer scientists. So we first ask these students here who understand the communities, how communities, the community dynamics. We ask them what are the problems of waste management. Then they bring this one, cause of disease, they create this, the city becomes smelly, you know, and so on and so forth. Then we bring the medic, what could be the problem? Then we bring the computer scientist and say, okay, what technology can you innovate putting together these ideas? And so in our Center of Innovation and Entrepreneurship, we've been able to come up with solutions that are all embracing. Actually, students discovered, those doing science, discovered that they needed to have their colleagues of arts and humanities. And the ones in humanities also used to say, these guys are arrogant, you know, they usually say those who do medicine and engineering are the cream and so on and so forth. Later, they discovered that actually their knowledge is also quite useful for them in the humanities. So we should promote that multidisciplinary approach in learning and also in knowledge. I would not actually, even when I'm hiring staff, I would be interested in a very holistic student or graduate, because you are technical enough, thank you very much. There are many more who are like you, but what else do you have that makes you unique? Do you understand society more than beyond your own qualification? So this is really the approach I would also go for.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Vincent, yes, you want to come in? I was going to bring in Aria. Yes, you can come.
To weigh in a bit. I think I did not say that the other discipline does not contribute towards development. But according to the research and which has been done through Sustainable Development Goal, especially for countries which are this third world country. The only way they can pull up to middle income and to that high economy is for them to prioritize science. It is a global campaign. It's a global campaign. That's why you see His Excellency, the President, who is not a scientist, has passionately embraced it, because it is a dynamics that is now driving the world. And research has been done. Some of those countries which were not doing well economically, like South Korea, China, when they prioritized the science, the economy went up. They started getting more engineers. And evidence, most of the things we are importing and using here is coming from those countries. Now, the idea that has come is not to see that we phase of humanity. Originally, there has been a very low enrollment of science in universities, and now the trend is changing. And actually, the goal which has been set by the country is not to see that humanity is phased off, because I think we are at about 12 to 14%. You find 12 to 14% go for sciences and at the university, and then the other big percentage are doing humanity. So they want to bridge that gap by increasing it to around 40%, and we are still low. And one of the research that was done by UNESCO, they actually advised the government, because first of all, they thought making science compulsory would actually boost the enrollment upward. But majority of these students were dropping science immediately after O-level. And a deeper research was done, and they discovered that the graduates, people who opt for sciences, even if you interview them, they are always top performing candidates at all level, because they have mastered the discipline. Science comes with some bit of foundation. You can't start it in the middle. So if somebody has grasped it well from the lower level, they are able to do better. So the best way to encourage them, because like 4-6 years ago, you find that a doctor was earning around 1.1 gross salary, which translates to around 900,000. So until government came up, because most of our graduates who would come out from the medical field, the good one would hop out to work from outside if opportunity avail. So government is trying, first of all, to attract and retain the scientists. Number two, to encourage majority of these students. Because if they don't see science, it is being paid better, how will they be encouraged? And we have seen a trend of improved enrollment, which has even been communicated by UNEB. Because if you look at 2012, in 2012, actually, we had the total number of candidates was let me begin from 2013, was 116,190, which is even bigger than the number now. But yet they had registered very few offering science in A-level, 2012. So the number at A-level has remained almost stagnant, but we are seeing a shift. The shift, the increase in science, is a sign that more students are hoping to do science. And there are many motivating factors that are leading to that.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
My guests also, I don't know that they appreciate it also. The one thing I like about Vicent is that he normally his analysis is 10 years ago. Yeah, he captures, he tries to make sure that he puts things into perspective, which is good. Aliyah, 996. Of your colleagues failed the exams. If you were to talk to them, I know I'm sure they are watching you. What advice would you give them now? Or they think that it's the end of the world?
My advice to them is never lose hope. There's always a way out. the situation, and there's, you can still do what you have always dreamt of doing, and I believe that all will be well. Just keep your hopes up and apply to as many universities as you can. Yes.
Professor, the 0.9, I know in terms of percentage, even when you compare, you can see at least there is an improvement. But you see, but it's not also good to have that figure there in the first place. 996 failing.
Yeah, I think it's very natural. Of course, many people would not want to actually appreciate this. There are factors why a student would fail. And as I mentioned earlier, this student has a record. By the way, some students fail later for reasons that have come in as extraneous. They have, you know, they have come all of a sudden. For example, you may find a very performing student all through loses his or her parent at maybe a month towards exams. There could be disruptions at the family level. So you find that for a particular subject even, you may find that they excel here when the calamity falls, and maybe that information is not managed very well to not to disrupt the student, because you have to choose. Do you announce to this student, the candidate who is going to sit a day after tomorrow, that your dad has passed on? Or do you want to keep this information until the paper is done? So there are different opinions. Some say no, they come to the school, they ask for permission, take away the kid. You can absolutely be sure that the chances of this student's mind being up to speed to focus on exams will not be as expected. But there are those who come on, you know, they really trail and trail and trail. And then, as my colleagues have rightly said, some students do final exams before even practicing with other exams before. You know, like the urban schools are at advantage. They actually pick past papers from different schools. They prepare the students, the answering format. Others have a language issue, so interpreting questions becomes an issue. We even see them, even you'll find students who have very good grades. Sometimes, by the way, they blame universities for having issues with the graduates. But students may come with an A, you know, in a subject, and they have comprehension and communication challenges. They can't even express themselves in writing very well. So universities spend quite a bit of time trying to refocus. That's why we have communication skills as mandatory. You know, for every student, whether you are doing medicine or engineering or education, whatever subject you are coming to do, we make sure we again tune you so that you now you are able to comprehend the language that is used at the university. So those who have failed, I advise them to try again. But you may even have the minimum grades that can take you to another tertiary institution. Please do not undermine that. It might take you a very, very long route to come back into the university system to do a degree. And many universities now, we also know that they also offer diploma programs, certificate and diploma programs. And you can still come in a university environment and then study. Take your time. Do not be in a rush that, oh, I'm getting old. And you know, by the time I finish a diploma for 3 years, then I do another 3 years at university, it will take me 6 years. Maybe that is a better route than dropping out of the education system and finding shortcuts of life. This is really my counseling. And the parents, sometimes parents, we have a problem. We push students to do subjects that they don't have even capacity to do. Somebody, you know, a parent will weigh in on a kid and say, "My friend, I'm paying a lot of fees. If you don't become a medical, if you don't qualify to do medicine, I will disown you. I will not even pay for you fees." These kinds of pressures are not very, very good. On the other hand, some good students who have capacity also become lazy. They have a choice. "No, I don't want to try chemistry." But actually, in him or her, there is capacity for her to actually excel in chemistry. So schools, rather than target grades and ranking, schools need to identify the learner needs and try to create a pathway for students who have potential but who are lazy and think that they can only just study things and go away. And also when we detect that now there's no more hope along those lines, we tailor the students in other areas, and then later they can always rejoin at postgraduate level.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Before I bring in Brenda, earlier you had said that there are reasons why you were interested in pursuing sciences. But Professor has talked about parents who are pressurizing their children that take this path. Did it happen in the first place when before you started thinking of which combination?
That is a lawyer.
Yes.
My parents are really free-minded, and it was my choice to do the sciences. They've never pressurized me. And yes, he has talked about how the children are pressurized. I've also seen my friends who have been pressurized, and they find it actually harder when parents are pressurizing them because they're not doing it out of passion. So they are compelled to quit sometimes, or they may perform well but again drop it afterwards and then go for other paths, and that is just a waste of time. So I agree with that professor, yes.
They are children to pursue, to do subjects they really interested or capable of doing.
Yes.
Yes, Brenda.
Thank you very much. You see, failing at A level may not mean this is the end of the world. These people still have hope. They can still find other things to do. But why did the child fail? It's something that has to be established before you think of anything you're going to do. Like Professor said, there are so many reasons. Able children fail to realize their full potential. It could be about the child got lost along the way. There are children who come to school and they just get lost. It could be about some unfortunate circumstance. Why did the child fail? Only a learner that knows what they didn't do well, that like you're sure, should I be given an opportunity to go back? I will do this, I will do this, I will do this, I will do this. And you see that once these are done, the child is able to perform. That child can go back and come back with amazing results. Very good. But there is a child that psychologically resigned, refused, and for some reason, like you've ably said, there are students sitting in class because the father said, because the mother said. But their parents, at the end of that day, it is the future of this child. Just like you are a party to this future, but this child will live the rest of their life after A-level alone. And A-level determines what you're going to be. So I beg that even as senior fives are planning to report on Monday, mm-hmm. parents, listen to your children. Listen to where are their abilities. Because A-level is unique, somehow different from O-level. Because you need to have the ability, you need to have the will. It's not like you can grill a learner and they pass in A-level. Because there's that personal touch they have to put to polish their...
So they're the ones who have chosen the subjects they have they're taking.
Yes, once they have chosen the subjects, because that's where schools come in to assist. Where is the ability? Because there's a child out there who could have done their best and things didn't come out. Well, so I wouldn't, someone who feels like they've exhausted their potential, I wouldn't feel like that child should go back. I would rather maybe opt for other careers available. Because by the mere fact that this child was in A-level, then they have good results at O-level. And also maybe this point that people need to look outside mainstream academics and look at other shortcuts to arrive at the final destination still. People are planning to join A-level on Monday, senior fives are reporting. Mm-hmm. But there are children who can opt out. For example, there's a child with grades where schools may not accept to give them the combination, for example, to do sciences. But those grades can give them a certificate, then after which they will do a diploma, do a degree, and can also become professors. So there is nothing to die for in going for A-level, especially when there is that evidence that the strength, because strength in A-level is needed. Not so, my friend. Strength is key in determining how the learner is going to perform. Explore. Someone can go for nursing, certificate in nursing, comprehensive nursing, nursing and midwifery. You know, they have options. So let A level not be a do or die.
So they should be allowed to explore
various options. So they should be listened to and they try out guided very well. Otherwise, there is no point in sitting 2 years and then you have F. And then you're stuck. They are gone, those 2 years. Yet if this child branched at all level, by the end of 2.5 years, these people are in VAC, this child is finishing their certificate in a certain course, and then they can proceed. So let them study the results, effort of the learner, will of the learner, and then proceed with the next step.
Thank you very much. Yes, Omar, Professor.
I think
yes.
There is one, I don't know whether the president or the chair of the science teachers can agree. There needs to be sometimes some overhaul of a particular policy. In some countries, if a student has undertaken physics, chemistry, biology, I'm just giving examples of subjects. You have three principal subjects, and the performance is poor in one of the subjects. Rather than do an entire three repeat, in other words, register and do again the same subjects, they would only do the exam in that subject that they have failed. So the issue of saying same sitting, you know, like two principal passes, same sitting, I think as part of the reforms in this country, we need to rethink, do we really need to maintain that? Does it have any impact? A student now did not pass biology, it is essential for medicine or pharmacy. Now, the other chemistry and the other subjects are passed well. Why is it not possible for such a student just to go back to their school and register for biology? And you can actually almost be certain, because all the concentration and focus will be on a single subject. So that policy matter needs to be thought about, because many of our students have two very good subjects. The essential subject is failed. Now, when they repeat, they even fail the subject they had passed in the first place. So it becomes so ridiculous and really very, very unrealistic, because
discouraging.
Very discouraging. I have my two in the bag. I have passed them. And I mean, the transformation of education needs to be somehow to be very, I don't want to use the word radical, but we need to think about measures that can assist our people. We know science is critical. We have a shortage of scientists. We have a shortage of health workers. We have a shortage of engineers. If those who have failed physics but they passed math and chemistry can be given an opportunity, like now we are going to phase out the curriculum. You know, if there was a thought, and UNEB can actually pick it from me here, if there's a consideration where students who have passed the other subjects and they have a single subject to receipt, they should be given an opportunity. Absolutely. You actually retake a paper. You do not go back to an entire semester. And I'm sure these ideas may appear very outrageous, but definitely they are food for thought. Even the subject that was passed, I know that we have now created higher education access program now, where students who have a principal pass that has failed, they have not been able to make it, they spend a whole year doing that. So another option would be going into the A-level system and allow that to happen.
Thank you very much. I think we are coming to the end of the show. We have like two minutes. I just want to use those 2 minutes to ask each of you to say your last word. Let me start with, I see Vicente.
Yes, before...
We have, less than 2 minutes.
Before I conclude, I think, allow me to weigh in also, just some 2 points. I want to agree with the professor.
We can just summarize and then you conclude, okay. Yes.
The idea of repeating a particular subject, I think it has been captured in the revised A-level curriculum, but only that has been put on what?
Hold.
I think it will solve that. Then the other thing is to improve those who have failed. I think when people look at performance, they majorly focus on teachers and then the learners, majorly that. But they forget. Forget that the parents are also key stakeholders. Mm. So my appeal to parents, because you'll find a parent failing even to buy a calculator, Like she was saying, her parents supported her. Some parents failed to pay school fees.
I'm sorry, I would have loved it, but let me just move to Aliyah. We actually have 1 minute.
To conclude, I'm appealing to the parents to support our learners, even when they are not doing well.
Thank you.
Yes.
Aliyah, your concluding remarks.
Yes, I'd like to thank you so much for hosting me. I'm really grateful. Yes, thank you so much.
And we congratulate you once again for
with
those flying colors. Yes, Professor.
I would like to invite all those who qualify to join university to come to Kampala International University, because we have a broad spectrum of programs, and we are the leading private university and second overall university in the country.
Thank you very much. Yes,
thank you so much for hosting us, and send greetings to the senior secondary school.
Thank you very much. I hope the show has enriched your understanding and broadened your perspective. We thank our good panel of experts that have been able to, I'm sure, to enrich your understanding and broaden your perspective. I've been your host, Umaru Kashaka. From me and the rest of Press World team, we wish you a fantastic weekend.